नमो वीतरागाय
नमो वीतरागाय,
नमो अरिहंताणम
नमो अरिहंताणम,
नमो सिद्धाणम
नमो सिद्धाणम,
नमो आयरियाणम
नमो आयरियाणम,
नमो वज्जायाणम
नमो वज्जायाणम,
नमो लोए सौवसाहुण
नमो लोए सव साहुणम।
ऐसो पंचन मुकारो
ऐसो पंचन मुक्कारो,
सौवपावप्पनासनो
सव्वपावप्पनाशनो,
मंगलाणं च सवे सिं
मंगलानं च सव्वे सिं,
परमं हवै मंगलम्
परमं हवै मंगलम्।
ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय
ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय,
ॐ नमः शिवाय जय
ॐ नमः शिवाय,
सच्चिदानंद।
जय सच्चिदानंद।
Hey, Sachyamadma, welcome. Mitha, you have a question? Go ahead.
Okay, so my first question was that, like just now in the three mantra, we just said "Eso Panchanamukkaro Sarva Pavapanashino," and this means that by bowing to these five beings, all of our sins will be destroyed, right? So my question was that, does this actually happen every time we recite the three mantra?
Yeah, it does happen if recited with attention, in the presence of our chitta and with understanding that to whom I am paying obeisance to. When you say namo, namo means obeisance, I bow down to. So if you do it with the understanding of Arihant, Siddha, Acharya, Upadhyaya and others, it does work. It does work. Basically, it reduces the intensity of the suffering. It reduces the intensity of the suffering. Sauva pava panasano, what it means is all the world in our worldly life, we do get upsetting situations or fruits of our sins, past sins. So the suffering, the intensity of the suffering reduces. The suffering will not cease, but the intensity will reduce. Typical example that the Bhagwan would give that if a 100 kilo stone were to fall on your feet, and instead of that, you will get the effect as if only a 25 kilo stone has fallen. So the intensity of the suffering reduces. And it does work. 100%.
Another question I had related to this was, I said that it will destroy all the sins. Why is it only the sins? Because to go to moksha, we also need to get free of pap and punya, right?
See, this is required if you are unable to bear the sufferings of the worldly life. Basically, for moksha or liberation, we have to get rid of all the positive as well as negative deeds, pap as well as punya. So that after having got enlightenment, what remains is simply exhausting of the deeds or the karmas that we have brought in this lifetime in the form of mind, body, and speech. So in the process of exhausting, if we face hurdles, if we face problems which we are not able to handle, and we require divine grace or strength, then we need to say this. If you have the capacity to bear and handle and manage them, then you may need not say. But typically, what happens is in this Kali Yuga, all of us have got some things where everything doesn't flow smoothly, in terms of education, in terms of career or job, job, in terms of family life, there are hurdles. And we wish that whatever assignment or work we are out to go to, you know, we are set to do, we feel that if it, we hope that it goes hurdle free. So yeah, we do say that whenever we leave the home or whenever we start, so if there are students who start studying or some many auspicious activity, we seek blessings in the sense, let there be no hurdles in the process of whatever activity I'm coming. Now, for example, in this Zoom satsang, or in any satsang for that matter, we always start with three words, that let our satsang be hurdle free. So that is the objective of saying this.
Okay. Anything else, Puriranji?
I think so. Yeah.
Meet, you got the answer?
Definitely, yeah, very useful. Dada Bhagwan would also recite it in the, before the start of satsangs. And it, it definitely, it's a very helpful. Other thing, now that you mentioned it, there's another out of this, that chalo, we may not even have a hurdle, but when we recite this, you know, all our upyog gets focused. All our, what do you call your chit, our focus, you know, attention. All our attention gets focused in the activity we want to commence. If I want to commence reading, for example, after 1 year, or if I want to, in your case, some studies or some important assignment. When you say that, the all our attention, which has got diversified and scattered, not diversified, but which is scattered here and there. The moment we say that with proper attention, it all gets focused. It comes back. The chit vrittis, which are scattered here and there, they come back to, in our this thing, present moment. And then we are able to focus in the activity. That is reading satsang. So it does help in focusing our scattered chit vrittis.
Okay.
It does help that.
Okay, Amit?
Yeah, Jai Satchidana.
Jai Satchidana. Thank you. Rishabh Bhai?
Yes, my question is regarding Chit. Jai Satchidana to everyone. Pulinandan Ji, Jai Satchidana. My question is regarding Chit. Chit, we have Ekagra Chit, which we focus Chit, which you mentioned. And also we have Ek Chit. So, I have heard about Ek Chit and Avdhan. So what is this Ek Chit, and can Chit be present in more than one place? This is my question, like something I heard about Sri Rajchandra Ji, that Chit is present.
Avdhan, yes.
Yeah. So what is this Ek Chit and Anek Chit? You know, what is that? Please explain, you know. Is it useful for us, you know, ek chit, or is an ek chit useful for us? This is the
question. Puritanji? Puritanji?
That in the end, then after Gnan Vidhi and all that, it becomes anek chit, that it is scattered it is scattered, but not in very large places.
Finanji, you were not audible from beginning. Can you please start again?
Chitta, basically, before we get self-enlightened, basically, chitta is ananta chitta. Anant chit means it is scattered at infinite places. Then, after this, it becomes anek chit. Anek chit means it is scattered in many places. And then gradually progress in our gnan, as we progress in five agnas, as we progress in atma jagrati, then chit vrittis, what used to keep going out, that slowly, slowly diminishes, and they don't go out so much. Or even if they go out, they do not get stuck outside. And gradually, over a period of time, they get stabilized or anchored in our the pure soul. then that becomes ek chit. So Gnani Purush was in ek chit. He would always, his chit would always be present where his body was, while eating, while doing any activity, you know, while doing any activity. So from anek chit means many places, scattered at many places, we gradually then start, automatically it happens, it starts focusing slowly, 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 and then it becomes ek chit. Basically, the chitta vruttis don't go out much. And even if they go out, they don't get stuck. That is the state where we are. And gradually, as our chitta becomes shuddha, it becomes pure. And as the chitta becomes pure, they cease going out. And they start stabilizing and remaining inside. A power of concentration also increases in the process. It is a fallout, because what happens is, why does the chit go out? You know, the chit goes out because it seeks happiness, and we are used to happiness of the five senses. You know, happiness in watching TV, for example, or good food, or moving around. You know, wherever we see any beautiful items, maybe a good flower, maybe nice scenery, or maybe a good shop or a hotel or whatever. So anything that attracts the five senses, the eyes or the nose or the tongue, we have a tendency is to get stuck over there. Ah, what nice, how nice. Basically, it is seeking happiness. Now, what happens is, the moment we realize ourselves after the Gnandi, we find happiness within ourselves. Since happiness is within ourselves, the vruttis then gradually start coming back. They don't go out so much because they have found that true happiness is inside. But whatever discharge chit that is there, the discharge chit, so that as and when, gradually, as it starts getting, what can we say, shuddha, you know, pure, as it starts becoming pure, the vruttis stop going out. And gradually they start coming inside. Then you will feel, oh, I've seen, sometimes we go, oh, what a fort to be seen, or what a museum to be seen when you go some tourist place. We feel, okay, dekhle, I've seen it, and fine, nothing great. So gradually the interest in the external five sense reduces. So once the interest reduces, the vruttis don't get stuck over there. And then they even stop going out. That is a literally later stage. And then it will remain anchored inside. And the more happiness it finds inside, oh, it's great. Gradually, step by step, it starts. Chitta is a very important thing. Dada used to say, "E ardha chetan che." In Gnan, when you are not enlightened, it's a semi-chetan, you know. It's a very important function. I have seen it, that even in worldly life, those who have not got this self-realization or Atmanyan, those people whose chitta is reasonably unpolluted, their power of concentration, the quality of decision making, the quality of creativity, the ability to find solutions in case of their problems, you know, are really one step higher than other people. Other thing I have found, that those whose chitta is not fractured, you know, chitta typically gets fractured in vishay, that is sex, and in all some people, you know, people whom we get attached to. So typically it gets attached, and then worldly things like a good watch or a good bungalow or things like that. So wherever it gets attracted, it gets attached. It attached, and once it attached, it becomes impure. That's the simple thing. So those who chitta has not been impure relatively, they are one step ahead of others in worldly matter. In terms of they draw respect from people, in terms of they are not very sensitive, they are reasonably stable in adverse situations. I have seen that. And those with chitta has become very impure.
But what about avdhan? There is ek chit or anek chit. In avdhan, what happens? In avdhan.
Then it is a power of
Kulinaniji.
Haji, bolo.
Just see this. 1 minute.
Yeah.
Just a moment. Can you read it? You're muted. Randy, you got muted.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. एक वक्ते जुदी जुदी बाबत ऊपर ध्यान आपवानी शक्ति या दैट इज ट्रू बेसिकली वी कैन इट्स अ कॉम्बिनेशन ऑफ चित्त एंड मेमोरी आल्सो यू नो दैट दे कैन रिमेम्बर एट अ टाइम सो मेनी थिंग्स श्रीमद राजचंद्र हैड शत उद्दान और 100 थिंग्स ही वुड बी आस्क्ड 100 टाइप ऑफ क्वेश्चंस और थिंग्स एंड देन ही वुड रिमेम्बर ऑल ऑफ देम एंड रिप्लाई देम बैक इन सीक्वेंस. So it is definitely a function.
Purijanji?
Pure chitta.
Purijanji, we lost you.
High order.
Network is low. Maybe you can try switching off.
Yeah, I switch off my video. Okay. Now maybe this is a little better.
Yes.
So basically, it is a function of pure chit, definitely. Definitely, it's a function of pure chit. So, it is not anek chit. His chit would be definitely reasonably pure. And only then you can remember or concentrate on more than one things at a time. You know? And that's why he had Shata Avdhan, 100 things at a time. He could remember and then answer them. Like that was
basic issue here is that Srimad Ranjandari is as in the definition, it is saying that you can do more than one activity. Now for Mahatma, it is said to do only one activity, focus on one activity. Now what is the basic means? But if many times happens for Mahatma also, they are forced to do more than one activity. So is it possible for Mahatma to do more than one activity? Or is it advisable? This is the concern.
No, see for Mahatmas it is very clear. Our chitta, we should prevent it from getting attached to worldly things. Chitta, we should prevent it getting from impure. So we should try to be in focus. In focus means we our attention or chitta should be wherever we are. In whatever activity we are doing, you know, if you are eating, working, playing, walking, whatever, be in the present moment, as they say. So chitta should be on whatever activity we are doing. This is the desired thing for Mahatmas. So as far as possible, they should focus on that. Wherever the chit goes out, then bring it back and remain in the present. You know, that is the thing for Mahatmas. Then and your second question was, they are forced to do many things at a time or more than one thing at a time. Then it is that situation arises occasionally. It's not every time that you have to do multitasking, you know, that you're on the phone and writing and also talking to someone and things like that. That does happen to some people some of the time. But if a person is able to do all that together, then that is his quality of his pure chitta, where he can attend or multitask 2-3 things at a time. Ideally speaking, what we are saying is that you must be in the present moment and watch what file number one is doing. Then it depends on your capacity, whether you're able to focus on one thing at a time. Ideally speaking, it should be one at a time. But you know, for example, if a shopkeeper is there, then he has to attend to 2 people and do 2 or 3 things at a time. He is talking to someone and gets a phone call, he has to attend to that. So he will multitask, you know, like a switching operation. A little attention to the phone, little attention was there, but he can handle both together. So that is the quality of his desirable is pure chitta. If the need arises, he may multitask. And as far as possible, he should be in one activity. Basically, chitta should be pure. Then depending on the situation, he may multitask, he may not multitask. Every time this multitasking doesn't happen.
So you say multitasking,
do one thing at a time.
So you say one task is better, but multitasking, if need arise, then maybe then it can, there's no option.
I would put it in a slightly different manner. If my chitta is a pure, and if the need arises for multitasking, I will be able to do it very nicely, very effectively, without getting upset. But if my chitta is not so very pure, no, and I'm focusing on one thing, and some other work comes, and the third work comes, then I'll get really upset. Hey, what's happening? I cannot work on so many things. A person gets upset. His capacity to handle more than one thing will not be there. So essentially, we have to focus on pure shuddha, pure chitta. And if the need arises, automatically you'll be able to do justice to more than one thing at a time. But those are, limited situations or rare occasions. It's not an everyday occurrence. Everyday occurrence would be that as you get up, you're walking, talking, you're just in the present moment. Your chit is where your body is or what your actions are. By that, you know what? You will not get emotional, you will not get upset. Even if some calamities happen, some disturbances come, you will be able to handle it very coolly, one by one by one by one. If your chitta is pure, the chitta is pure, this is the advantage you will get. You will be able to handle all things one by one in a peaceful and a cool manner.
Okay.
So chitta shuddhi is the ultimate. In fact, all, if I may just add a little,
yes,
all religious activity, all spiritual, in fact, even in the Kramik Marg or in the traditional spiritual practices or by other religions, the idea is to improve or purify the chitta. All religions look at purifying the chitta in their respective manner. Some do it by bhakti, bhajan, some do by concentration, some do by whatever ways, In Jainism, people do puja. But puja is done in other religions also. Then wash, bathing the idol of the deity. So all those activities were designed so that the person's chitta becomes shuddha. It becomes pure. Because he's focused, by devotion that, I'm bathing the Lord. Then I'm doing tilak to the Lord, then I'm putting on clothes to him. So that devotion and presence of the chitta improves or helps in purifying the chitta. So chitta shuddhikaran or purification of the chitta is the prime goal of most religions in different ways. They do it in their own respective ways. And in our case, after getting enlightened, our chitta becomes truly shuddha to a limited extent, because our gnan, chitta means gnan plus darshan. Gnan and darshan put together is chitta.
Yeah.
Our gnan darshan becomes pure the moment we can learn. In the sense, who am I? I am the pure soul. I is that understanding. I am the pure soul is the experience. So we get that experience. So our chitta has become shuddha, but to a limited extent. And whatever impurities are still left by way of discharge, those are the things by way of agnas and all, gradually it starts becoming pure, that's the line of action for us. So chitta shuddhikaran is a master key in everywhere, whether it is our akram marg or whether it is karmic. It is the king. Chitta is the king in the body. And that I was to say, adhema jo koi raja hoi to chitta che, ardha chetan che, semi atma.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Jai Sachidanand.
Yeah.
Hey, bhai.
Jai Sachidanand, Navina bhai. Pulin bhai.
Bhai, aap humko Navin bhai bana dete ho.
Nahi, sorry. Yaad nahi. Dada had given five statements, that is real and relative and kudrat events. According to the means kudrat means you have to understand what events going on your body and relative parts, that is the side, the nature. Let the chit will go to anywhere, but you have how much attention in your mind. That is more important. This is the statement, something or wrong. That attention, you have to keep it.
Basically attention or jagrati. I may make a translation of jagrati, it is awareness. Basically, we have to maintain a constant vigil or a constant awareness on file number one or our Prakriti. And observe what events are happening to file number one. And what are the external situation on file number one? What is the reaction of that of file number one? And as you said, even if the chitta, or the impure chitta of file number one goes out and we observe it, then
observe only because the kudrat will do. Kudrat will do whatever she want. He want actually.
It is not kudrat. If I may use Dada Bhagwan's terminology, the terminal right term would be vyavasthit shakti or scientific circumstantial evidences that will operate on file number one according to the karmas it has brought. And we have to observe what vyavasthit shakti is playing out its part. But what are the evidences or what are the situations or circumstances that arise, and what is the happiness or suffering that file number one is getting, or whether file number one is happy, excited.
As per the kudrat rachana designed by the God or the relative part.
God does not design. We are the designers. Kudrat rachana
already decided by the relative part, no?
Right. Whatever karma we have charged, that then goes into the computer or nature, and then it comes as effect in this birth. And when it comes in effect, scientific circumstantial evidence means summary of all results. Jo bhi effect hai, whatever effects we have, the summary of that then comes as the vyavasthit shakti, and then we get the result, whatever it may be, good, bad, you know. If I want to go from place A to place B, and I need to go by a train, then that I may book the ticket, that I may get reservation, that I may reach the railway station on time, that the train may start, that the train may not meet any accident. Those are all various scientific circumstantial evidences. And the coming together of them properly take me from place A to place B. So, vyavasthit shakti, observing vyavasthit shakti is seeing what are the events playing out. If I reach from A to B on time, I must remember, thank God, all the situations fall in place properly. But if I'm unable to go in time, then I must remember one of the evidences is not working out. So it is getting delayed. So this is how observing scientific circumstantial evidence helps us in remaining equanimous.
That is the point. All these rules are there. Okay. Sir, question is going on in my mind. That Brahma is said to be the creator of whole nature or whole universe. Is it right or wrong? Because when Atma will go, merge from the body, and it means dissolution going on and creator itself, then who decided that this Atma go to the moksha or let it to take the birth again here? Who is going to be decided?
That is exactly what Dada Bhagwan has revealed. That is exactly what Dada Bhagwan has revealed, that God is not the creator nor a person who runs the world. That Brahma is the creator is a one-on-one viewpoint from one school of thought. But truly speaking, in fact or in reality, no one is the creator. God is not the creator of this world at all. That is the Bhagwan's statement. Who has created? Scientific circumstantial evidence run the world. And how have they been generated? The individual person generates those situations. We, in our ignorance state, we charge the karmas and we generate the situations. For example,
Mahavidya Chetra is already generated.
Is geographical. That is different. If you're talking of kshetras, the entire Brahmand entire चौदह लोक geographically has been there since infinite times, when remained since infinite time. Physically, you know, this world, this Prithvi, or Mahavidya Kshetra, or Bharat Kshetra, or Moksha, or Devgati, or Nargati, all these are already there.
And so on, all these things. Anyway, what I'm saying you, if you are not, God has to realize experience for having to bless for the Atma or soul, let this Atma have to go to the moksha or not to go to the moksha. Who is deciding all these things?
God has no power, na? By God, what do you mean by God?
Who is deciding?
God means the true soul.
No. Who is deciding that this Atma has to go to the moksha or again take to the birth and the anywhere and any loop? Who is deciding all these things?
The individual jiv himself decides that. The ignorant ahankar, the ignorant ego decides that. Depending on what it feels happiness
Atma
like.
Is not deciding.
If you feel happiness is worldly like, God has no power to decide. God means pure soul. Pure soul does not have any power to do any activity. It has only one, Jnata Drashta, observer, knower and seer. Bas, that is the only property or quality it has. It cannot do any physical activity. Physical activity is done by this Udgal or this ego. So charging of karmas is done by them. The individual himself decides whether I will go to Devgati or I'll go to Moksha, depending on his state of ignorance and his karmas. God cannot decide. God has no, so he does not have that property at all. Gnan, Darshan, Charitra, all those properties do not have the capacity to do. Kriya is only the Puddal and Ahankar. Only two things can do the activities.
After
also cannot do. It is that ahankar, ego.
Then in Hindu mythology, I just read that somewhere, that God, after the death, the soul, God has to decide it, this Atma will go this way, this Atma will go this way, according to their karma and all this thing.
But see, that is, Dada used to say that is for people whose development has not advanced. For childlike development, for them, this is one of the stepping stones to tell them that God will decide this, God will do that. So please God and do bhakti of God. So that is one way of driving people to go towards God. That is one way of driving people to go away from their ego, that I can do this and I can do that, and that doership ego, to drive people away from that, or to people, this is one school of thought, that leave it everything to God, God will do this and God will do that. If you don't do this, then God will punish you. So that there is some sense of fear, there is some sense of respect.
God have the conformity to the divine of the plan regarding to whole universe.
So this is just a means of helping some set of people who has a limited development, but it is not true in fact, in actually or in reality, that is not true. For people who are scientifically bent and want to know the absolute truth, for them it is the person, individual person, who decides his own fate. Khud ka nasib khud banate hai. Person decides or makes his own fate, So he decides which gati or which life form he will take, whether he'll come back to human being, animal, devgati, nargati or moksha. That is decided by the individual. Because there is no other person who runs the world. The beautiful thing that the Bhagavan has revealed,
whatever the kudrat event is going on in your body. One question is arising in my mind, ki kudrat event is going on as per your whole body. Okay. Hello.
Yes.
So I have to take the sannyas. I have to take all these things. Tapasya. I have to take engineering. I have to take the Aptaputra. All these things. So who is deciding? I myself, I am whole and soul responsible. That is correct or not?
100%. You, Dada Bhagwan says, you are whole and soul responsible for yourself.
So I read somewhere that God have to realize experience, divining blessing for the Atma or a soul, where it have to go. Because how the soul will go to anywhere? Who will be decide that ahankara or whatever it may be?
And the pure soul has no capacity to go. It has got covered because of the pudgal or the karmas. It is covered because of the karmas.
Somebody should be there who have to measure all this karma. This is zero, this is 20%, this is a 10% wala karma. Who will be decide all this thing?
That is the whole beauty. That is the whole beauty. This is the exact secret Dada Bhagwan understood very well. And then he called it Vyavasthit Shakti does that. And I can tell you, it is very, very true to whatever extent I have understood that the coming together of all the six eternal elements cause events to occur. And it is self-operating. No person decides.
Self-operating
it's a natural phenomenon.
जय सच्चिदानंद पुलिन आनंद जी, जय सच्चिदानंद रजनीकांत, जय सच्चिदानंद दीपक भाई, जय सच्चिदानंद महात्मा. See, if everything is vyavasthit and we cannot change anything, so Param Pujya Dada Bhagwan always used to say that Simandar Swami's images takes residence in every home, and when these images are worshipped with deep reverence, so how do we change the situation, the vyavasthit over here? When his aartis are sung in every home, when his temples are constructed all over, there will be heaven on earth. How is it? If everything is vyavasthit, how does this change?
So this also is part of the vyavasthit. What Dada Bhagwan has said, that is also part of the vyavasthit. What he has said, that India has a bright future. When the Vitrag Bhagwans of Simandar Swami will be worshipped in every home, there will be a lot of positivity and India or the world will prosper. That's basically it. So it is not we are doing it individually, but this is his design. And as this Vitrag Vignan or this Vignan will spread, as people will get enlightened, even by Akram or even the Kramik Marg, people will get enlightened in their respective religions. You see, they will understand their respective religions in the perfect form as designed by the originator of that religion. There will be a lot of purity. And that purity will change the environment of the world and India. You see, this is what he has predicted, that this is the road ahead. That is why he has encouraged that everybody, if possible, should worship Simandar Swami, because he is the present reigning Tirthankar. He's alive, you know. So now Mahatmas, we have the capacity to do Pursha. We can be away from the Prakruti. So by way of Pursha, for in our best interest, in our personal best interest, the more we worship Simandar Swami, the more we will generate karmas which will lead us towards him in the next birth. So for us, we have some this thing, and it's a general prediction, general thing, that as the Vitrag Marga or the Vitrag sayings, the sayings of the Vitrags, as it spreads around in India and all over the world, people will understand what is proper humanity, proper religion, where is pure happiness, and all this negativity, violence that is there, that will slowly come down. There is no other way to reduce the negativity around in the world. So he has ultimately said the purity will always come in the form of an enlightened being, which means the Tirthankara. So worshipping him means worshipping his qualities, and worshipping his qualities will generate those qualities inside. So it will remove all the violence and negativity from individual. That will in turn lead to goodwill and prosperity of the world.
Okay, that way. Okay. Like I wanted to know more about the Vyavasthit Gyan. This I understood. Like deeply, like the entire knowledge in a nutshell about Vyavasthit. Because like I was sitting with myself yesterday and I just thought, ki sankalp vikalp stops. You know, your anger, your moh, your expectations. You don't make new karmas for your new birth. So it's a very big science, Vyavasthit by itself. So can we have a deeper meaning to it? Can you put some light to it?
Ah, you are very right. Vyavasthit is a very, very deep science. And Dada Bhagwan himself has said that today you have understood Vyavasthit in the school or the physical this thing. Then you will understand little subtle meaning, the sukshma arthusta. Then sukshmatar and sukshmatam, subtle and subtlest, you know. And when you reach to that level, you will be fully enlightened or you will attain Keval Gna. So we are all in the process of understanding Vyavasthit vis-a-vis our own life. You know, if you look at our own life, file number one, what are the events occurring in and around? So, and if you relate it with Vyavasthit Shakti, that so many good things happened in my life, so many circumstances came together by which I could succeed in something, by which I could not succeed in something, and no one individual was the doer, but coming together of circumstances led to this. The more and more we are able to grasp it in our context, you know, that I tried my best to be healthy, but something other something other happens, and there's a puncture in my health. I want to do exercise, I want to do this, I want to do that, but some reason it's not clicking, or for some reason everything is falling into place, and I'm able to achieve my goal. I just exercise was one thing, and it could be say money making or getting married or career or any of that, maybe a hobby, whatever profession. If you see that we are how evidences come together and an event occurs. If you develop the capacity to observe that, you know, we will start realizing how Vyavasthit is playing a part. Even a person getting an inspiration to do something, or let me do this, you know, that also is part of Vyavasthit. You know, everybody knows I should not be eating this, but I keep eating it. Everybody knows I should not be doing this. I should be getting up early in the morning, but he does not get up early in the morning. Then one fine day he gets inspired by somebody, then he decides to do it, and then it works. So somebody coming to him, getting inspired, putting it into action, this is all Vyavasthit. That only when the time ripens, when the time
But is ripens, it is it also the time of Kal and space together put to that Ghat Bandhan, if you put them together
The four things. Radha Bhagwan said that in the discharge part, in the discharge that is occurring to us, for anything to happen, Dravya, Kshetra, Kal and Bhav. Dravya means the physical entity or being. Kshetra means the space. Kal means time. And our Bhav means our inner desire. And when the four come together, an event occurs. For example, the typical example given by him was that if I want to get a haircut, then first thing, I will have a inner desire that I want to cut my hair. So that is the bhav. Then I will go to the saloon, hair cutting saloon. But there I will feel the shutter is closed. So I ask what happened. But he says that man has got some function at home, so he has not opened his shop today. So I came to the kshetra. You know, I had the bhav to cut hair. I came to the place, but I could not do it. So I go the next day again. Next day, the shutter is open. The barber is there. I go to him. So I am able to meet the barber. So the third evidence of Dravya, first thing was Bhav, then Kshetra. Bhav means my desire, Kshetra means that space, and then the Dravya means that the barber, the person of the thing. All three are there. But what he will say, sir, I'm cutting this fellow's hair. You please sit down. After I finish him, I will take you. So my time has not ripened. Then when he goes away, then the time ripens. So when all the four come together, the event of my haircut takes place. So if we observe this in our context also, which I do quite often, we can realize this, when all the four come together, that your success event takes place. So this is just to understand the phenomena of Vyavasthit, how it is operating, you know, one aspect of it.
Yeah, there's
and
one
the more
more.
And more we realize that vyavasthit is the key thing, and we only have the bhav sakta, then what happens is we'll be able to take whatever comes to us more equanimously. So understanding like, vyavasthit is a prolonged thing, and it's a gradual thing, and step by step we understand the finer nuances of vyavasthit.
Actually, we have taken real and relative in consideration. So now we can start on vyavasthit because the knowledge is so deep. I don't know, I was sitting with myself and it just went on. It stops your anger, your desires, you making new karmas, you know, stopping the new life, you know, like stopping all those karmas. I have a small question. Man, vachan, kaya. Ki avastha vyavasthit hai. Then beautiful book is written, published by Dada Bhagwan, Vani Vigyan. How can change the vyavasthit of vachans? How can the book change the Vani Vigyan, you know?
Basically, it also depends. On what understanding we carry, what intentions we have, you know. So we, if your intentions change, that I do not want to hurt anybody by speech, then if I understand that why that person is doing which I don't like, you know, if my understanding changes of the situation, my intentions change, then it will get reflected in the appropriate vani. Typical example was that. I read this somewhere else that in London in a metro train in one of the stops one lady boarded the train with a small child. Now the child was very very irritating, run up and down, then he would hit people and he would shout, and it was very disturbed and hanky-panky. So initially, all the co-passengers in the train did not say anything. They just frowned and neglected and things like that. But when it went on for a long time, then passengers got really irritated. And then one of them told that lady, please handle your child, you know. He is causing a lot of disturbance to everybody. And everybody is disturbed or irritated. So what the lady said was that this child has just lost his mother. He didn't have a father. There was no one to take care of him. And I'm just taking I'm taking him with me to my home. So the moment people came to know the true story, everybody's feeling about the child changed. And everybody developed a lot of sympathy for the child. And then they apologized and said, oh, I'm sorry. If you want any help, let me know. You know? So when the vision changed, the viewpoint or the understanding of people changed from a frustration or irritation towards the child, it changed into sympathy for the child. So as we
actually, it always happens. We do not see things as, we do not see things the way we are. We always see it on a superficial level and start judging. That's what. You were saying something, and
we
I
do not see
it
from an absolute angle. Yes, we do not see it from the vitrag angle or the absolute angle. We see it from our viewpoint. And when we see things from our viewpoint, it leads to clashes and differences of opinion. Precisely. So when we start seeing things from others' viewpoint, when we start seeing things from the natural or the vitrag viewpoint, you know, our understanding stabilizes or develops. Our intentions are there not to hurt. Then the combination of the two, then that leads to a change of speech.
Very true. Very true.
Okay, Hanuman.
1 minute. 1 second. I think Chandra has one question here. 1 minute. I'll just hand over my phone to her. Chandra.
Yeah. Video on the plate.
Here. Yes, Tanan. Yes,
एक क्वेश्चन वन क्वेश्चन दादा भगवान ऑलवेज यूज्ड टू से मन वचन काया की अवस्था मात्र कुदरती रचना है तो मतलब व्यवस्थित राइट मन वचन काया की अवस्था व्यवस्थित इज इट राइट? अवस्था तो काया की अवस्था समझ में आती है, लेकिन मन की अवस्था एंड वाणी की अवस्था वो भी व्यवस्थित है, वो थोड़ा क्लियर नहीं होता है कि वचन की अवस्था हम व्यवस्थित होता तो हम इतने बुक्स नहीं पढ़ते थे, वाणी का भी क्या नहीं पढ़ सकते, और मन के लेवल पे जैसे इसके ये जन्म में जो भाव करेंगे तो नेक्स्ट जन्म में होएगा। तो ये मन की अवस्था और वाणी की अवस्था ये दोनों की कैसे व्यवस्थित है? काया की फिर समझ में आती है, अवस्था व्यवस्थित है, तो कैन यू एक्सप्लेन मी मोर लाइक
बेसिकली इन द सेंटेंस?
हाँ या
मन वचन काया की अवस्था कुदरती रचना है। इन दैट सेंटेंस ऑल दादा भगवान इज ट्राइंग टू से दैट माइंड स्पीच एंड बॉडी आर नेचुरली जनरेटेड no one has created them. That is all he is trying to say. That means there was no creator of your mind's body speech. You created your own mind body speech. God or some other person was not created, and it has got created naturally. Naturally in the sense, whatever bhav you had done in the previous birth, that drew those atoms. That drew those type of atoms, and then that resulted into you getting this type of a body, this type of speech, and this type of mind in the next birth. Your bhav has drawn those type of parmanus or atoms. You see, so that is what he means by saying that it is.
But can we change in this?
That means it is a natural phenomenon. It's a natural phenomena that has happened. Your bhav is the one who has generated or created that. That is all he's trying to say in that sentence.
Yeah, yeah. So
the
can
present
we change?
Mind wasn't really. Yeah, sorry.
I want to ask, can we change mind and speech? Can we change? We have control on mind and vachan, yani like. Speech, can we control?
We cannot. Yeah, speech, yes. Speech to a reasonable extent, you can definitely control or change. And see, now this is a very dicey statement, you know, very dicey and can generate a lot of controversy.
Yeah.
Change in what sense we are understanding? You see, we can reduce the intensity of the hurt. We can reduce the intensity of the wrong things in the speech, and it can become very mild and tapered. And by generating the desire that I want to have sweet and soothing language, then your language will definitely change. And but if you say you cannot change, then you will never be able to do it. For example, when you are at a traffic light and the policeman halts you, doesn't your speech change? Are you aggressive and this thing dominating on him? No. How his speech is over there?
Right,
when you are in, it is inappropriate to say. Scientifically, yes. Scientifically, we have charged the speech in the form of tape recorder. That is it.
Yeah.
Our intentions, previous birth have all got charged. Now they get executed based on the knowledge or intentions that we have in this birth. Now when our intentions are reversed, so that whatever is charged, that goes through a filter and it gets diluted to a very large extent. Because that pushad we have in this birth, changing of intentions. So, and the intensity of that changing and the intensity of the charge part, it's a combination.
Yeah.
We lost you, Mithanji.
Or interplay of both the forces.
We lost you, Puritani.
So whichever. What to do now? Am I audible now?
Yes.
Okay. So it is the interplay of our present intentions and whatever we have brought from the past. So it does definitely, it does have a diminishing effect, because what happens in our case is we become separate from the body. You see, we are separate from the body. And because we are separate from the body, we have a lot of control on the body in terms of observation. As far as mind goes, we cannot change the thoughts that will come, but we can change the impact it has on us. Whether we get engrossed in it or we don't get engrossed in it, whether we are able to manage our thoughts or not, that purushartha is there with us. You know, if there is an incessant, continuous string of bad thoughts or a flow of bad thoughts coming, then we can use diversion and many other techniques. So thoughts will come, but the impact it has on us, whether we are able to remain separate as an observer, that is our individual purushartha. So if we remain separate as an observer, it will not affect us. And if it doesn't affect us, we can say it does not matter whatever happens, a good thought or a bad thought. I'm simply an observer.
Yeah, most often I have seen.
We are remain unaffected.
Most often I have observed after hearing the gyan, our situation. Previously, we used to fight and all. So that also changed because of the vani, because of the bow. So I used to shocked when everything is vivasthit, how it has changed my life. You know? So everything is written to
basically. But what happens is after gnana, you know, our
after hearing the gyan. Vani changed. My vani changed. And my mind also changed, my bow also changed, and my situation, family member, my situation has changed. And so I used to fight, and it has also changed. How to become change? And because due to, if it is everything is vivasthit, so there is a major role of the vani and major role of the mind and bow and all, isn't it? And they also work on vivasthit, and they can overcome, right?
And it is not like that, you see, it is not like that. It should be understood separately. Basically, it is gnan plus external circumstances that result into effect. Now, previously, when I am the name bearer, that gnan was there, so the different effect was coming. The moment it becomes I am the pure soul, the whole gnan changes, you see, because of that gnan changing, na. The results of output also changes. It is gnan plus that results into effect. So the gnan portion has changed. So the intensity of all what you are saying, my speech and my fighting and all changed. The ego has been withdrawn, you see. The charge ego is withdrawn. So only a discharge ego remains. So the whole intensity drops down. Typically, if you want me to summarize that, in an example given by Dada Bhagwan, that if I have a ball and if I throw it from 4 feet height, it will go down and again come up, go down and again come up. But if I tap it when it comes up the second time, then again it will keep bouncing back the same height. But if I don't tap it, gradually the height will keep increasing and the ball will stop bouncing. So that is exactly that is happening with the prakruti. The tapping portion has gone away. So gradually the prakruti is exhausting and diminishing. That's the change you are observing.
Oh, I see. Yeah. Very true.
Okay.
Yeah, very nice.
That is Chandrabai. Okay, Jai Sachidananda.
Yeah.
Okay, we have 3 minutes, so let us see what Krishna has.
Jai Sachidananda, Pulinanaji, Dipatananaji, Radhanyanko. I actually mean Krishna talking, and I got little point, but my question is when the situation happened, let's say there's an argument you have with someone and relative realize that, okay, maru bulche, like Nimish did problem and that person is a stranger. We do pratikraman, we do, you know, bow that not to hurt in any time in the future. How and other, and that person keep on coming in our mind. Is the effect there? Are we doing properly? Mean Krishna talking that the stickiness of the file depends also on how many times you have to do pratikraman or do change your viewpoint on that person. But if that person doesn't, you don't know if that's reaching them, how you know forgiveness, you know, that I saw a fault and I'm trying to find resolution. How we know that it's reaching on the other relative file?
So if I may summarize the question, what you're saying is, if there's a stranger and to whom which we had some dispute, and now you are repenting and you are doing apology. Or your question is, how do I come to know whether what pratigaman I am doing is teaching the other person or not? Right?
Yes. Yes.
So see, every pratikraman definitely reaches the other person. Definitely reaches the other person. But you may not, and you may not see a change in his behavior, because the intensity of the hurt is higher than the intensity of the pratikramans or the number of pratikramans. If the intensity of the hurt, by whatever means, by speech or action, and if the intensity or the number of pratikramans match up, then it will definitely result in change in his behavior with us. That we can experience it. So whether my pratikraman has reached him or not, the answer to that is, if sufficient and the required number is done, it will lead to a change of heart in him, and it will definitely result in his, it will definitely result in his a change in his behavior with you. But times it may take more time also, depending on the intensity of the heart. You see, it may happen in one day, it may happen in 5 days, it may happen after 5 pratikramans, it may happen after 500 pratikramans. That variable factor is there. But every pratikraman does have an effect. What it every pratikraman does is, it removes one layer of friction between the two. Second pratikraman, second layer is gone. Now, if the intensity of the hurt is of 500 layers, then it will call for 500 pratikramans. Okay. As simple as that. I know of one Mahatma who told me that I did 5,000 pratikramans of my husband, after which his behavior with me changed. With extreme patience and a sustained effort over a long period, she could square up a very tricky affair or a very tricky resolution or hisab, that we say, with her husband. I'm just telling you, what we call a chikni file or a sticky file. So if it is very sticky, it may take time. But on an average, with strangers, it is not so very sticky. And a few pratikramans here and there definitely give results in our day-to-day life.
Okay. So my follow-up question quickly is, then what happens is humans, they become emotionally attached on the situation. It may be a little simple conflict, but the emotion, how the relative feel, that is what sometimes I'm challenged with is, I saw my fault, I'm doing pratikraman, but that situation, that emotional attachment is still there. So how I can resolve that?
You have to change your attachment. You have to apply some other gnan. You have to apply some other gnan or understanding by which that emotional attachment can diminish and the pratikamans can start working.
Okay. Yeah. Jai Sachidana.
Okay, this our time is up. So please do 3 minutes, please, and Krishna and Namisha, please follow.
Namo Vitragai.
Namo Vitragai.
Namo Arihantanam.
Namo Arihantanam.
Namo Siddhanam.
Namo Siddhanam.
Namo Ayariyanam.
Namo Ayariyanam.
Namo Uvazayanam.
Namo Uvazayanam.
Namo Loe Savasahunam.
Namo Loe Savasahunam.
Eso Panchana Mukkaro.
Eso Panchana Mukkaro.
Savapavapanasano.
Savapavapanasano.
Manglanam cha savesim.
Manglanam cha savesim.
Adamam havai mangalam.
Adamam havai mangalam.
Om namo bhagavate vasudevai.
Om namo bhagavate vasudevai.
Om Namah Shivaya.
Om Namah Shivaya.
Jai Satchidanand.
Jai Satchidanand.
Jai Satchidanand.